Welcome to Northwest Christian Church. We're so excited you're here today with us. We're going to worship the Lord this morning, but would you stand with us as we pray? Father, we pray that you would come now in power and in glory. Lord, bless this time as we worship together. Give us your peace, Holy Spirit. Fill this place. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. Good morning, church. Go ahead and grab a seat. We are so glad that you're here worshiping with us, that we get to celebrate that the good Father loves you and I. How great is that? Amen? So, hey, we're really encouraging you to make sure you fill out a Connect card if you got a program or find one in the seat back. We'd really love for you to be able to fill that out. Let us know how we can be praying for you. We're a church that cares for one another, and we want to pray for one another. We're not trying to get into your business, but we're kind of saying, you don't have to do this alone. You and I can go to the good Father, and we want to do that for you or with you. Or if you have some other people that you're caring about or you're concerned about, let us know, and we want to share that with you as well. Also, I wanted to highlight one thing out of the program, and that is Night to Shine. One of the coolest events that we ever get to do, right? Somebody clap for that, all right? This is a special needs prom, and we've been doing it for a number of years now, so we have some special needs guests that we just love, and we invite them that we get to celebrate that they get to go to a prom, and then we're going to have the red carpet rolled out for them, we're going to have limo rides, we're going to have some karaoke, we're going to have a banquet for them, there's going to be a DJ dancing, all kinds of opportunities, but we need your help. And so we want you to be able to serve in that. So if you were to go to the serve kiosk between services, that would be a great opportunity for you to go ahead and sign up. Maybe you can help us decorate before the event. Maybe after the event, you can help us tear down and clean up. Or maybe you want to be a buddy. You want to be a date for that special needs person. We would love for you to do that as well. All right? I have one other thing I want to do is I want to introduce to you one of our new pastors. This is Joe Teep. All right?
So Joe. Well, there we go.
There we go. All right, I'm not going to leave
you
here.
Hello, everybody.
Joe's our new pastor of adult ministries, and so we're really excited to have him on board now this week. I want to give you a couple things about him. First of all, Joe is originally from the Bay Area, which means...
I'm a Niner fan.
Woohoo! Do not clap for that, all right?
Way to make a first impression, am I right?
Now, he wised up, and he moved to Eugene, which means that he's a...
I'm also a duck, so let's go Ducks. Don't worry, when it comes to engineering or baseball, go OSU. There it is.
So, he got a degree from U of O, got a degree from Western Seminary. I just found this out last week, and if I would have known this earlier, this would have been a game changer. But Joe is also a cat person.
I sure am.
I think we have a picture of your cats.
We do. So, I know, right? So that's Zorro on the left and Ziggy on the right. I love them.
The great thing about Joe, though, is he's married to Caitlin, and his wife, Caitlin, he married way above his grade level. All
sure
right?
Did.
So, she's still in Eugene transitioning.
She's actually here this weekend today.
I knew she was here the weekend. So, right after the service, when we have people pray, Joe will be up here. His wife, Caitlin, will be here with him, and you can introduce yourselves to them, or if you want prayer, they'll be able to pray for you as well. I've asked Joe, since he's here today, to ask our greeting question before I get into the message. So, Joe, we're going to have everybody stand up. They're going to find somebody to talk to. And what's the question they're supposed to ask?
Well, I grew up with dogs and cats. Love them both. But if you had to choose, which would you choose, a dog or a cat? That's the question
All right,
for
stand
this
up,
morning.
Let's do it. Hey, grab a seat. All right, I need to find out. How many of you are cat people? Let me see your hand. How many of you are more enlightened or like dog people? All right, there we go. Okay. Hey, it's really good to be back, and I'm so thankful for God's faithfulness. I'm thankful for your prayers, for your cards, your messages, your food. You have been so kind to Julie and I, and so we're so thankful to be here. But we're in this series called 2020 Trip Check, and we've been looking at this new decade, this new year, and we've been using this as an opportunity for us to make sure that we're doing a trip check, that we're trying to make sure that we're ready for what God has for us in this new year and this new decade. And we started by saying, you know what? You got to make sure you know where you're heading, because it's really important to know the direction that God is calling us, the path that He wants us on. Yogi Berra once said, if you don't know where you're going, you'll end up someplace else. And he's absolutely right. So we need to know where we're going. And now that we know where God is calling us as we work through that message, we said, well, you know what? We got to pay attention to the dashboard. Because on our dashboard in our cars, there's some gauges. And these gauges are really important to pay attention to. Because what happens with these gauges is they tell us whether or not we're running out of fuel, whether we need some more water, whether there's enough air pressure in our tires. And it's important that we pay attention to those gauges, because if we don't, they can sideline us from the trip. And so what I believe is that God has given us some dashboards for life as well. He's given us some indicators that you and I can look at and we can assess on how we're doing, and we need to pay attention to those. So that'll help us make sure that we get where God has called us to do it. So we need to do that and pay attention to that. And now every week what we're asking you to do is to do a real quick trip check for yourself and your own family. So in the insert, there's this spies thing. And we're just asking you to do that real quick every week and then share that with your, maybe your home fellowship group, maybe your life group, your connect group, whatever group you're a part of. Or maybe you just share that in a family. Hey, this is what's going on this week. This emotional area, this is where I'm really struggling with. Physically, I'm really down this week, and can you just pray for me? We're asking you to get kind of in that rhythm, and so hopefully this will help you to do that. That's a tool for you. Last week, Chris did a great job looking at the temperature gauge. And the temperature gauge is important because, well, we looked at that as a metaphor for anger. Because if we're not paying attention to anger, I'm telling you, that'll sideline us. That'll crash us on this trip that God has called for us. And it'll also take some other people out as well, and we don't want that to happen. Before that, it was all about the check engine light. We believe that God's word has some important guidelines for us on how we're going to treat our body, because that is the temple for the Holy Spirit. This morning, what we're going to do is we're looking at that tachometer. This tells us how many RPMs that we're doing. If your engine is always revved up, if it's always going full tilt, if it's always at the extreme, I'm telling you, you can't do that for a long, long time without having some troubles. You'll never, ever get to your destination if you're always revved up. I don't know if you've ever blown a head gasket, if you've ever seen all your engine oil on the ground instead of in the engine. It's not good. There's talk about engine trouble. That is really a difficult time. None of us in this room want that for our life. We don't want that for our destination. We don't want that on our journey. And so what we're going to do this morning, we're going to look at the tachometer. We're going to look at some of the pressure that we sometimes put, or that other people put on our life, that can sabotage our life, that can sabotage the trip. And when that happens, what happens is we are short-circuited on the journey. We end up maybe in the shop, or we end up on the side of the road somewhere, and we're never going to get to the destination that God has called us to. I want to begin by showing you a couple pictures. You should recognize this guy, Tom Cruise, right? All right, from Top Gun. Going to be a sequel out there. He has a famous line where he says, "I feel the need for what? Speed." All right, "I feel the need for speed." Now, if you've seen a picture of Vin Diesel and Paul Walker, you know that they are in a film called The Fast and the, or one of the 50 sequels, all right, something like that. Now, if you're as old as me, you didn't have Cartoon Network. You didn't get to see cartoons unlimited time. You had to wait until Saturday, and when it came Saturday, then you could watch cartoons at least Saturday morning. And so oftentimes on Saturday morning, we would see a picture like this. We would have Wile E. Coyote and this really fast bird. So a slow coyote is chasing this fast bird. And this show is called the Road Runner. Exactly, right? So in our culture, for years and years and years now, you and I have been inundated with this idea about speed, the need for speed, the fast and the furious, the Road Runner. It's all about speed. It's all about winding up that tachometer. And so what happens oftentimes is you and I just have this built-in, this sense that we need speed in our life as well. There's a comedian that said that he installed a microwave fireplace in his house. He was asked, "Well, why did you install a microwave fireplace in your house?" And he said, "Now I can spend an evening by the fire in just 8 minutes." All right? It's kind of amazing what happens. I want you to look at this guy. This guy here. He's the pop-a-shot champion of the world, all right? Look how fast he's going there, making all those baskets. I mean, it looks like the Blazers could use him right tonight, right? But he's just really fast. Again, in our culture, it definitely seems like we have this tilt for going full blast, running at a pace that is full tilt as well. In light of your New Year's resolutions, my guess is some of you said, "You know what, I'm going to be committed to be on the treadmill more." I want you to look at this video of a treadmill workout. This is the way it should be, all right? I like this. This is my exercise program for 2020, all right? But here's the deal. This morning, I want to look at a familiar story to some of you, and I want to use this story to help you and I to understand and look at our dashboard, specifically, again, the tachometer. And what I want us to see is I want to see that speed. I want us to evaluate the speed at which you and I are living our life and see if we have some areas that we can maybe pay a better attention to. So open up your Bible or your Bible app to Luke chapter 10, and I'm going to begin this passage in verse 38. And here's what we read. As Jesus and the disciples continued on their way to Jerusalem, they came to a certain village where a woman named Martha welcomed him into her home. So we got Martha, that's part of the character here, all right? Has a sister named Mary, sat at the Lord's feet. Mary's listening to what he taught. But Martha was what? What's that word there? Distracted. Why is she distracted? By the big dinner that she's preparing. We go on. She came to Jesus and said, Lord, doesn't it seem unfair to you that my sister just sits here while I do all this what? I do all this work. Come on. Tell her to come and help me. Jesus, come on. This is unfair. But the Lord said to her, my dear Martha, you're worried and upset about all these details. And then he concludes this way. There's only one thing worth being concerned about. And Mary, guess what? Mary has discovered it, and it will not be taken away from her. Let's pray. Father, thanks again for the opportunity to dive into your word. God, we're praying that you're going to open up our eyes, you're open up our hearts. God, that we'll pay attention to what you want for us, that you want for us today. So Lord, help us as we do this. In Jesus' name, amen. First of all, I want you to notice that Martha's tachometer is really humming. All right? I mean, she's at the red line. I mean, she's getting after it. Finally, when she does pause, she looks around, and she gets ticked off. I mean, she's really upset, right? Because she sees her sister Mary. And there's probably a couple reasons that she might be upset, right? First of all, she didn't listen to Chris's message on anger last week. That's the first problem, all right? Or it could be that she's doing all the work. And she looks around, while I'm doing all the work, what's Mary doing? She's just socializing. Hey, that's not right. Maybe she feels like her sister Mary has a better life. Because all Martha does is she works and she works and she works, and that's not Mary's life. Or maybe she's just tired of being behind the scenes. Mary, she has a front row seat. She's right there with Jesus. And so what I want you to see is that Martha does this thing called compares. Martha does this comparison thing, and I'm telling you, it's dangerous when we play this game of comparison. Can we just say that comparison is unhealthy? Let's just be really blunt and put it out there. It can be so dangerous for so many of us in this room as well. Because comparison, it will lead to frustration, it will lead to dissatisfaction, it leads to competition oftentimes. Martha kind of has, I think, this kind of attitude. If Martha's going to work hard, she wants Mary to work hard. If Martha's going to be tired, I want Mary to be tired. If I'm going to be miserable, I want my sister Mary to be miserable as well. So basically, Martha says, as I look, as I compare my life, I want to make sure that Mary, that she has the same kind of life that I do. And so you know what? I have the right to complain because this is just not fair. And that's not right. I've shared some of my concern about this before, and I want to share it a little bit again because I think it's relevant in this message. While I think there's a lot of good things that happen with social media and it has a lot of benefits, I think it's also a driving force behind a lot of frustration and dissatisfaction, and it centers around this whole idea about comparison. Social media is to envy what gasoline is to fire. Please hear this again. Social media is to envy what gasoline is to fire. I'm telling you, if you're constantly always looking at Facebook and Twitter and Instagram, and that's all you're doing, right, you're going to be constantly faced with this temptation to compare your life to whoever posts this or whoever tweets that, right? And that will become the dashboard of your life. That becomes the only gauges that you're paying attention to. And if that becomes the only gauge that you're paying attention to, I'm telling you, you're in for some struggle in life. Because what happens for a lot of us when we see all of these comparisons that we're doing, we feel the need for speed. Because in our culture, we've learned that if we're not first, then we are what? Last. We're last. And so this culture, now fuels this need for speed, because we got to keep up with the Joneses. We got to keep up with everybody else that we see posting on social media. And so we begin to live our life at an unsustainable pace. Because again, when I look at everybody else's posts, I see that their whole life looks fantastic, and mine, well, not so much. I mean, these parents on Facebook, man, they know exactly what to do with their children. I'm just screwing up my family. I mean, their house has been remodeled by Chip and Joanna Gaines, and my, well, I don't have anything close to that. I got to get after it, right? I got to get moving. I see somebody had a great vacation over at the coast. I got to go to Hawaii for my vacation. I got to up them. I see somebody bought a purse. I need to buy a new car. That's what we think we have to do, right? And we become fueled with this comparison. And of course, advertisers and marketers and the media, they just drive this point home even more. They cause even more pressure, causes us to wind up even more, right? You deserve the good life. You see what they have? Hey, you need this as well. It's not right that you don't have what everybody else has. And so we kind of get faced with that. Now, the other issue that I've often also mentioned this before is that oftentimes what people post or tweet is not always the way their life really is. Can we acknowledge that? There's some social media influencers. Imagine that. That's a new job, right? You can be an influencer through the social media. Periodically, I've seen a couple of these influencers. Now they're posting what their real life looks like. Here's one. This is who she really is, right? This is who she is. But when she posts on Facebook, that's what she looks like. She says, hey, guess what? It's not the same thing. Now, this also might be a shock to some of you, but what people advertise and what they deliver are sometimes two different things. I mean, for example, take a look at this cheeseburger, all right? Wow, what a cheeseburger. We got that lettuce, the tomato, we got bacon. That cheese just looks so scrumptious, right? And so we see that, and you know what? I'm going to order myself a cheeseburger. So you order yourself a cheeseburger, and when you get your cheeseburger, it looks like this. What's the deal here? I mean, that's not even close, right? It doesn't compare. I'm telling you, social media is the same way. It's a lot alike, right? It's created this platform where people present themselves as polished. They project themselves as they're all together, no flaws, no imperfections. And so what we say is, say, I want to be like that. I want to have what they have. I want to look like that. I'm going to do whatever it takes. I'm going to speed up my life. I'm going to work whatever I have to do to have that kind of life as well. And so we wind up our life and we go full tilt, whatever it takes, right, to get the same thing, because we think that's what's real. That's what everybody else has, and therefore I want to have that as well. Can we just pause for a moment? Can we just say that there's no perfect, polished people out there, or even in here for that matter, right? I think all of us know that up here, but sometimes it doesn't translate to here, and that's what drives and motivates us oftentimes. I know a lot of you know what OCD stands for. Talks about obsessive compulsive disorder. Maybe you're plagued with that. There's a new clinical distinction as well, where OCD stands for obsessive comparison disorder as well. And that's a true distinction. And one writer, Paul Anjone, he describes it this way. He says, obsessive comparison disorder is our compulsion to constantly compare ourselves to others. He goes on and he says, producing unwanted thoughts and feelings that drive us to depression, consumption, anxiety, and all around joyous discontent. That's what happens. He says, every day we're trying to pull off a branded, dazzling, filtered, edited, and possibly epic, otherworldly life that no one else could possibly be living. He also says this in regard to obsessive comparison disorder. We have a quote up here. Take a look. He says, whether it's in relation to outward appearance, academic success, financial gain, or even spiritual prominence, this is destroying a generation. It's destroying a generation. We can't let that happen. Can we just go back for a moment, and can we continue to listen to Jesus? He looks at Martha. It says, Martha, basically what's happening is you're distracted. You're distracted by stuff that doesn't even really matter in the big thing, big picture. Now, it's interesting, this Greek word of the original language, that it's basically two words, distracted is, that are kind of shoved together. So it's a compound word, and it means so basically that we're going to drag something around, that we're unnecessarily dragging some things around. And so what it seems to me that a lot of people do, maybe even some of us, too many of us, we drag around this mindset from our culture where we hear every single day, you got to run faster, you got to do more, you got to go harder, you got to accomplish this, you got to accomplish that, you got to do whatever it takes. To the point that so many of us were trying to get that perfect resume, to have that perfect job so we can go on that perfect vacation, so that we can have a perfect family, so that we can have this perfect life that we think everybody else around us is living. Some of you are trying to get this, a perfect body, all right? Not my body, but although that was rather insulting that I think about it. Wow, all right? But think for just a moment, would you? Would you just think for a moment about what is distracting you? What is causing you so much exhaustion? Why are you so tired in life? What is it physically, emotionally, spiritually, again, that is distracting you? My thinking is that these distractions, these things that you and I, that we're carrying around, this mindset has our tachometer red line, right? And I'm telling you, if that's you this morning, then you're carrying around some stuff that Jesus nor the Heavenly Father, the good, good Father, wants us dragging around. He doesn't want that for you. He doesn't want that for me either. And this causes issues that are reaching epidemic proportions. I mentioned in our fall series when we were talking about anxiety that 62% of college students say that on a daily basis they are dealing with overwhelming anxiety. 62%. This anxiety and depression comes from the pressure that they feel to get good grades. Again, so they can get a good job, so they can have a good family, so that they again can have that good life. Suicide for college students is at an all-time high. This is not from Jesus. This is a byproduct of our culture. 50 years ago in this country, people on the average slept 2 more hours per night than we do today. Can you imagine if you had 14 more hours of rest, what that would mean for your life? Because so many of us were running so hard and we're running so fast without, again, the proper rest, without the necessary breaks, that these expectations, they get the best of us, and they're having some tragic consequences. The National Spelling Bee, right? A spelling bee for elementary kids, just a really good thing, right? What they now discovered is they have to have a cry room right off stage. Off stage, because when these kids make a mistake, and who among us has not made a mistake, but when they make a mistake, they go right to the cry room so they can get their act together, so they can pull themselves together before they meet their demanding parents or the press that has all kinds of questions on why they're such a failure. Can you imagine that? Although I'm thinking about having a cry room right off of here just for me, all right? Who knows? Meyer Friedman, he's a cardiologist who coined the phrase type A personality. He did some landmark research, and he showed basically the connection between the fast, furious, the frenetic lifestyle, and cardiac issues, or heart issues. He actually says this. He says, hurry is a sickness. Hurry is a sickness. He goes on, he says, it's a continuous struggle and an unremitting attempt to accomplish or achieve more and more, to participate in more and more events with less and less time. Frequently, we're facing more and more opposition, whether real or perceived. Does this resonate with any of us here this morning? He's absolutely right. I want to throw down the gauntlet this morning. I want to challenge you this morning. Here's what I'm asking you to do. I'm just asking you for 5 days. All right, just one short week to start off this new decade. In the next 30 days, would you take 5 days? 5 days where you get home from school, you get home from work, and would you just clear your calendar where you're not going to go anywhere else? You're going to just take your evenings back. And I know already I'm scaring some of you, because already you're running in 2020 at such a fast pace that you want to avoid silence. Oftentimes we don't want to have this time by ourselves or with our family because we avoid ourselves, because we want to avoid our thought life. But I'm asking you, would you just take 5 evenings back, and would you just spend those at home? where you eat at home, where you exercise at home, you read a book, you play a game, you spend some time with each other. You can invite some other people over to your home, but you're just going to spend some time there. You're going to have some conversations. I heard a phrase recently, and I don't really like it, but then I thought about it, and I really need to like it. Maybe it resonates with some of you as well. And the phrase is, I will live slower so that I can live longer. Let's just repeat that out loud together. All of us say that whole phrase together, all right? Ready? I will live slower so that I can live longer. Wow. Think about that for just a moment. I don't know if you've ever seen Henrietta the Chicken. This is a cartoon. Henrietta provides us with eggs, and when she stops laying, we're going to eat her. All right? Next panel says this. She's at the grocery store picking up another dozen eggs, Henrietta. Isn't that how some of you feel, though? Man, I got to produce. I got to make sure I don't let up. I got to produce. Let's live slower so that we can live longer, right? Several years ago, there was a fascinating study about a frenzied lifestyle, the fast and furious lifestyle, and they were trying to kind of point out some things, and I think it was really just an amazing study. What scientists did is they take 20 mice and they injected them with a dose of amphetamines. And then they just observed these mice as they put them each in a separate box. And they just observed them. And they would track how fast they were moving around. They would track how far they would go or when they would stop and when they would rest and when they would fall asleep and then eventually when they would die. The next part of the study, they took another 20 mice and they injected them with half the dosage of the first group. But this time they put all 20 mice in the same box. And this is what they discovered, is they discovered that the mice ran around twice as fast, and it seems they were playing off each other's negative feelings, the negative emotions there, right? All that negative energy, and all 20 mice died prematurely. They had another study, and they took 19 mice, and they injected them again with half the dosage of the very first group, and they put them all in the same box. And then they took a separate mouse that had not had any drugs injected into it, and they take that separate mouse, and they introduce him to the other 19 hopped-up mice. And they put that mouse in there, and you know what happened? Also died prematurely. Also became part of that frenzied lifestyle. Also dies. Just an amazing study, right? I think the point is pretty clear. And maybe you've seen it in your own life. I know that I've seen it in my life. That the pace of our life is becoming increasing exponentially, and it becomes unsustainable. At the very least, it has to be unhealthy. We will recognize that. This is why Jesus, our example, our model, this is why he says to us in Matthew 11, listen to what he says. He says, are you tired? Are you worn out? Are you burned out on religion? He says, come to me. Get away with me, and you'll recover your life. He goes on and he says, I'll show you how to take real rest. Would you walk with me? Would you work with me? Watch how I do it, is what he says. And he goes on and he says this. He says, learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. And then he kind of concludes it. Keep company with me. Would you hear that? Keep company with me, and you'll learn to live freely, and you'll learn to live lightly. That's what Jesus calls you and me to. That's the lifestyle. He wants to show us how to really live life. He wants to show us how to rest as well. Walk with me, work with me, watch me, he says. Learn the rhythm of grace. The bottom line is, would you learn to keep company with me on a regular basis? Don't just go through the motions. Don't just give Jesus lip service. We got to learn to take a deep breath. We got to decide to live slower. We got to let that tachometer wind down. We got to give it some rest. We got to let it idle every once in a while. This last fall, we took a group from the church to Israel. It was a great trip, and we were looking forward to that. We went to a kibbutz, and we listened to this man named Menachem. And Menachem, I think we have a picture of him up here. Menachem, he's telling us about the Jewish culture. He tells us about the Jewish culture, both past and present. And as he talks to about us, he zeroes in on the Shabbat. He really shows us about the Shabbat and the idea about the Sabbath, and it's ingrained in their culture today. And they slow down on a regular basis. They spend some time in rest. They focus in on the Lord, and they focus in on family. That becomes the focal point. That's a regular rhythm, a part of their life, every time that Sabbath comes around. It seems to me that we, or at least I should say I sometimes just pay lip service to this idea about Sabbath rest. Because the tachometer continues to whine and scream 7 days a week. We need, or I need to take a look, and I need to learn to let it idle every once in a while. You and I need to make sure that we're taking that Sabbath, that we're learning to have some rest, to have that rhythm that God commanded from the very beginning. Commands for our own good, for our own life, for our own family as well, for this journey that all of us are on, so that we need to be intentional. We need to make sure that we're spending regular time on learning to unplug, to unwind, and spending time with the Lord, keeping company with Him. Sometimes the question that I ask is, why do we run so fast? Tim Keller, he addresses this question in his book, Counterfeit Gods. This is what he says. He says, our contemporary society is not fundamentally different from ancient ones. Each culture is dominated by its own set of idols. He points out that each has priesthoods, its totems, its own rituals. Each one has shrines, whether today it's our offices or our towers, it's our spas, it's our gyms. For some of us, it might be a studio or a stadium. And he says that's where sacrifices must be made in order that we might procure the blessings of the good life and ward off disaster. What are the gods of beauty, power, and money and achievement but these same things that have achieved now, assume now mythic proportions in our individual lives of our society? He goes on and he says, we may not physically kneel before the statue of Aphrodite, but many of our young women are now driven to depression and eating disorders by their obsessive concern over body image. That is real. He goes on and he says, we may not burn incense at the idol of Artemis, but when money and career are raised to cosmic proportions, he says, we perform a kind of child sacrifice. Because now we neglect our family, we neglect our community, we neglect our church to achieve a higher place in business and gain more and more wealth and prestige. He says, many people eventually realize they sacrificed everything to the god of success, but it wasn't enough. In ancient times, he points out, the deities are bloodthirsty, impossible to appease. They still are today. And I don't know about you, but when I heard that the first time, I just go, wow, unbelievable. Maybe in some of these consecutive nights at home, you can look at your tachometer. You can see the toll that it's taking. You can look at your pace of life. You can look at your Shabbat, your Sabbath, and where you're at. What's the toll it's taken on you, on your family? Well, let's go back to our text. We got to look at the other person in that story, and that, of course, is Mary. Her tachometer does not always seem to be at the red line. She seems actually pretty content to just spend some time with Jesus, pretty content not to always be busy. She actually seems content to let Martha do all the work. That's just my type A personality coming out, all right? Just saying that, all right? Mary seems content, though, not to compare herself with other people, even her sister. She's not driven to do what everybody else around her is doing. She focuses in on what she believes she should be doing right at this moment. Can we just say that Mary is content with who she is? She's simply content, and her contentment leads to a right perspective. And this right perspective is a godly perspective that leads to the right speed. It leads to the right rhythms in life, the right focus in our life as well. When you and I, when we learn to be content with our good Father on who He is, when you and I learn to be content with who we are and who God is creating us to be, I'm telling you, that's when life becomes good. That's part of the abundant life. When we understand that we are sons and daughters of God, that we are co-heirs with Jesus Christ, that we are ambassadors for Jesus, when we understand that we have an eternal inheritance that will never perish, spoil, or fade, that's important. That's when you and I become content. Because we recognize the last thing we need to do is compare ourselves to anybody else, because that's not what it's about. We don't need to compete with other people. I don't have to strive to beat anybody else. I just want to be right with God. And so what happens, on the contrary, when we're there, we want to celebrate. We celebrate other people. We celebrate when good things happen to them. We want to encourage everybody that we come into contact with, because they also are creations of God. That's what we want to do. I got a book up here. Just kind of want to show you. I know it's not a Kindle or electronic book. All right? But you'll notice that they have some white space on here. It's called margin. And they've done a lot of research on this, and what they've discovered, the researchers have, has caused publishers now to put between 37 and 40% of white space on the pages of a book. The white space is the space on the top and the bottom, on the sides, in between the sentences, in between words as well. And what they've discovered is that when a person will pick up a book and there's an appropriate amount of white space, they'll be more inclined to read that page because they're not overwhelmed with all of the words there. And so they'll not only read that page, but they'll turn to the next page and they'll read that and they'll read the chapter and then they'll finish the book. And they say that the converse is also true as well, that if you cram more and more words on there, what typically will happen is they become overwhelmed. And so therefore, they're not going to read that. They're not going to go ahead and finish that. They'll never go ahead. They'll never get as far. Now, I want you to think about that in just a little bit of a different context. Would you think about that for just a moment as the context of your life? Do you have enough margin? Is there enough white space in your life for you, for your family, for the people around you? When they see your life, do they see that your pace of life is differently? That you're not trying to keep up with everybody else? You're not trying to compare yourselves to other people? You're not trying to compete with everyone? They don't sense that you have this need for speed? Because when that happens, what goes on is your family is going to be healthier. People feel safe around you. They feel welcomed around you because there's space for them. And that's why it was so important what Jesus said to Martha. Remember what he said? He said, there's only one thing worth being concerned about. And guess what? Martha, I want you to know that Mary, she's discovered it, right? And it's not going to be taken away from her. Martha's learning, and I think you and I need to learn as well, that life is rarely a choice between good and bad. Oftentimes, I think it is a choice between good and better. What is the best choice, right? What's going to be better for us? Martha's cooking a meal. Nothing wrong with that. People need to eat. But he says, I want you to know your sister has chosen to spend time with me. She's learning about life. And Martha, I want you to know that's a good thing. This is better. When you and I learn that we need to spend time with Jesus, we're going to have that contentment that we desperately desire. And again, then we don't have to wind up the engine all the time. We don't have to look at what the Joneses have. We don't have to compare about all social media with what everybody else has. And we got to have that as well. And when you and I get to that place, when we don't have to compare, I'm just telling you, life will be different for all of us. It's going to make all the difference in the world for you and for me as well. Because you know the bottom line is that we really fully understand better that God loves us just the way we are, right? I'm like a lot of other people, maybe even some of you in this room, is that I oftentimes fall short. I don't measure up. Sometimes I miss the mark. Originally, that was an archery term. In Scripture, it's used the word sin. Anybody else here ever miss the mark? Everybody else ever sin here? What I've discovered is even when I fall short, is that God wants to pick me back up. He extends this thing called grace. He loves me anyway, even when I've missed. It doesn't matter where I've been. It doesn't matter what I've done. And because we're not comparing, guess what? I get to learn to extend grace to other people around me as well. I want other people to experience that kind of love. I want other people to have that kind of margin in their life because I know this is what I'm experiencing as well. Robert Tuttle was a doctor in Milwaukee. He tells about a time that he was in the third grade. He was 9 years old, and he said, never happened to me before, but I was humiliated because I wet my pants. I wet my pants in the classroom. I didn't know what to do, but I'm scared to death because if the kids find out, I will be teased until I graduate from this school. I will always be known as the person who wet his pants. I just pray, God, this is an emergency. God, you got to help me. Help me, God. And just at that moment, my teacher stands up and she begins to come to my desk. About the time that she gets to my desk, just before she gets there, there's a girl named Susie who's carrying a fishbowl. She's also coming to my desk. And when she gets there, she trips and stumbles and the fishbowl goes into my lap. Water goes everywhere. All the students start laughing. Robert said, I tried to act upset, but inside I'm saying, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Well, all the students, they start making fun of Susie and begin to ridicule her. The ridicule that should have been mine is hers. Later that day, she's at the bus stop. I see her outside. She's just standing by herself. And then she comes up to me and she simply says this with a smile. I wet my pants once too. All of us. All of us have fallen short. All of us have messed up. God gave us his son Jesus. He didn't just come to the desk. He went all the way to the cross for you and for me. Would we learn to extend grace to other people around us? Would you be better at that? Would you make sure that you're checking your tachometer periodically this week? Would you understand that you need to make the best choices, choose the best? That you would choose Sabbath, that you would choose rest, that you would choose to spend time with Jesus on a regular basis? And then would you share that good news with other people around you? I want us just to have a little bit more time, a focused time with Jesus right now in a time of communion. And so as the band comes up and as the ushers get ready to serve us, again, we're going to spend some time to remember that Jesus didn't go to that desk. He went all the way to the cross. The ridicule that you and I should have because of our sin, Jesus took to the cross. The shame that you and I should feel because of our sin, Jesus took on at the cross. And so every week we pass these trays with stacked cups. And those stacked cups have two emblems in them, right? One cup has a wafer of Jesus' body, a reminder there. One has some grape juice of his blood that was shed for you to take your ridicule, to take your shame, to take my ridicule, my shame. And so as you take those elements when you're ready today, would you just say, thank you, Jesus, for going to the cross for me? And then we always want to have this great time and end with generosity. God is a good, good Father who's been so generous to us. God calls us to give back. We call it a tithe where we give 10% back. We have offerings that are above our tithes. We have faith promises above our tithes and offerings where we give back to God. And we say, thank you, God, for everything that you've given us. And we want to honor you. And we're going to be generous just as you've been generous to us. I hope that's part of your rhythm of life as well. Let me pray for these elements. Then we'll worship some more as we celebrate what Jesus has done. Thanks again, God, for this time. God, I know that you're doing some incredible things in us and through us and among us. Help us to be quiet enough to hear you. Not to be fearful that you're going to do something, but God, that you want something for us. And now we're reminded of what good, good things you do as our good, good Father. That you give us your Son, Jesus Christ, who would go all the way to the cross and take my ridicule, my shame. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Thank you. your foe, still your love by me. You've been so, so good to me. Well, I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. You've been so, so kind to me.
Transition now into a time of generosity. So if the ushers would come forward, we're going to continue to worship.
Take these hands, I know they're empty, but with you they be used for beauty in your perfect plan. All I am is yours. Take these feet, I know they stumble, but you use the weak. You use the humble, Lord, so please use me. Take this heart, Set it on fire, shine it in the dark. I want to tell the world of who you are. All I am is yours.
Amen. Amen. If you've not surrendered your life to the Lord Jesus Christ, if you're not all his, we would love to be able to have a conversation with you. If you're ready to surrender, Mark will be up here, Jan's up here, Joe's going to be up here. We'd love to talk with you, have a conversation, pray with you, whatever it takes. If you have something else going on, we want to do that as well. And also, just a reminder, when Joe comes up here, you can show him a picture of your cat as well. All right? Let me pray, and then we'll get out of here. God, it's good to be in your house. God, I pray that you would be pleased with what's said and done here today. God, that each one of us would have been encouraged by singing your praises, your anthems, God, to know how much you love us. God, be challenged because of your word. God, whatever you do through your Holy Spirit, God, we're so thankful for that today. In Jesus' name. And everyone said,
amen.
Have a great week.
Amen.